Well, welcome to panel three. We will be talking about future priorities for global health coordination. Frankly, the need for coordination on global health is intuitive. We're talking about threats that do not know national boundaries. But the reality is that coordination has not always been evident. That was especially true in the early days of the pandemic, and also especially true on the distribution and production of countermeasures against COVID-19. And the anger and the legacy of that lack of coordination still reverberate, really, through global health, and are a topic that we deal with in thinking about the future priorities for coordination. We are blessed to have an all-star panel today to discuss these issues, including many friends and all people I admire. In the interests of time, I am going to introduce them only by their current titles. I hope they and you will forgive me for not delving into their very impressive backgrounds. I'm going to start with the people in the room and then move on online. To my immediate left is Peter Hotez. He is the Dean of the National School of Tropical Medicine at Baylor College of Medicine, and also the co-director of Texas Children's Center for Vaccine Development. Next to him is Amadou Sall, who is the director of the Institut Pasteur Dakar. And next to him is Winnie Byanyima, who is the executive director of UNAIDS. On our screen, coming in remotely, we have my good friend and CFR colleague, Tom Frieden, who is also the CEO of Resolve to Save Lives. Next, we have Peter Piot, special advisor to President von der Leyen on the on European and global health security for the European Commission. And next, we have Chikwe, Ihekweazu, who is the Assistant Director General for the Hub of Pandemic and Epidemic Intelligence at the World Health Organization. Thank you all so much for joining us today. My question to the panel is going to be the same, but it is going to be in two parts. The first question I have to ask is how the successes and failures of the COVID-19 crisis have changed you or your organization's priorities for global health coordination, and what is one opportunity you are taking to try to advance those priorities? And why don't we start to the far left with the executive director to lead us off, please.
Thank you, Tom. I start by congratulating Ambassador Nkenga Song and your team for launching the Bureau for Global Health Security and Diplomacy and organizing this important meeting. I lead the United Nations Joint Program on HIV/AIDS, and we have 27 years of experience fighting HIV/AIDS. It's not over, as you just heard. When COVID struck in 2020, we fought hard working with our partners like PEPFAR, Global Fund, supporting governments and communities to keep the HIV response on track and to contribute to fighting COVID. Four things. Many of the partners we fought with are here, like Africa CDC. We were with them from the very beginning, led by Ambassador Nkenga Song, then Dr. Nkenga Song, fighting for personnel, protection equipment, fighting for the vaccine, fight every step of the way. Four things we learned from HIV that we were trying to get into the COVID response with some success, but a lot of failure. One, that global health security requires global coordination of a multi-sectoral, all of government, all of society approach. We tried that in some countries, bringing in what HIV had taught us with some success, but we didn't succeed globally. The world came together to create UNAIDS We set the global standards, we set a strategic direction and targets. The whole world comes together to raise resources. PEPFAR is the biggest bilateral program to respond to a global pandemic. This global fund created 20 years ago that brings together donors to finance a global response. All this didn't happen. There were some targets set for COVID. Secretary General kept saying, by this time we should have so many people vaccinated, but there was no plan behind that target. There were no resources behind it. So we failed in that respect. The second is about sharing technology. By 2000, there was ARV treatment available here in the North, but 12 million people died in the South, mostly in Africa, because ARVs were beyond what they could afford. Through activism and through generic production, now most people, 28 million people are on treatment, 30 million are on treatment today. You may be in Ouagadougou, you may be in London, you can get the same ARV tablet priced differently. This was an achievement of the HIV response. Didn't happen this time. You know the story of how vaccines were hoarded by a few companies out of reach for most countries, and 1.3 million lives could have been saved that were not saved because of that hoarding. We fought for a TRIPS waiver for 1 year at the WHO. Most countries wanted it. A handful didn't want it. We never got the TRIPS waiver. Sharing technology didn't happen. Millions died. Economies shut down. We could have saved that. The third is financing. Again, developing countries were already hit by debt. They were paying four times more for debt servicing than they were putting in the health of their people. They said we need some debt relief. All they got was a suspension for 2 years of the debt service. That meant nothing because they were still paying out more to debt service than to fighting COVID. Common framework of G20 didn't yield anything until COVID was over. So financing that came together up to today for HIV, we still have a PEPFAR program putting billions into saving lives, 25 million lives saved today by PEPFAR alone, one bilateral program. All this coming together to finance a pandemic didn't happen for COVID. Lastly, communities. You heard Professor Fauci here say that the most important thing for him as a leading expert here was the empowerment of communities to fight for their lives. This did happen in some countries. South Africa, we saw them use the same communities they brought together to fight HIV, do the contact tracing, do the work, connect with scientists to fight COVID. And that is why they registered some success. That country with 8-10 million people living with HIV was also fighting COVID. We need communities to lead for themselves. So in short, four things: global coordination of a multi-sectoral approach, all of government approach is needed, sharing technology, life-saving technology is needed, ensuring that there's funding for every country to fight, and letting communities lead. Those are the four things that come from HIV that we try to bring it into the COVID response with a little success somewhere, but with failure at the global level, I'm sorry to say. Thank you.
Great, thank you so much. We're gonna stick on the multilateral theme, and I'm next gonna go to Chikwe Ihekweazu, please.
Thanks, Tom, and also congrats to Ambassador Kengerson and his team. I'll focus on one bit. There are many areas one could pick on, but let me focus on a shared experience that we all had, and I think all lived through. From whatever country, wherever we sat, we watched our leaders literally in real time struggle to make decisions. And one of the reasons for that, there were many other reasons, but one of the reasons for that was that our systems in public health were just not prepared, developed, designed, or implemented in a way with the agility, flexibility to give these leaders the information that they needed to make the decisions with the agility and speed they demanded. So, you know, when you think about the evolution of the HIV epidemic, and Winnie alluded to that, we had a slow burn pandemic evolve, and the data and analytical demands were different. And we had the time to think, to go back, to analyze, to derive hypotheses and come back with possible answers and design a response. Unfortunately, with the speed and intensity of this pandemic, we simply did not have that privilege. And in public health generally, our national public health agencies, our science institutions, just did not have that ability to access not only health data, but all the other related data systems. So on that particular problem, and there were many others, but the emergencies program acted literally within the pandemic. So similar to when the health emergencies program was set up post-Ebola, you know, almost immediately after. This was during the pandemic. We realized, WHO realized that there was a gap and set up within the emergencies program a new division called Surveillance and Health Emergency Intelligence Systems, which then included the new Pandemic and Epidemic Intelligence Hub in Berlin to support ourselves, support the organization, and support our member states in getting better at collecting, using, analyzing information to make make important public health decisions with the time, with the precision, agility that was needed to react to a pandemic. So really one of our key lessons from this is that there's a big gap. And while we've started working on this in Berlin, working on it in Berlin will not be enough to solve the problems around the world. The most critical interface are the countries to support our leaders in countries, ministers of health, heads of national agencies to do the same. And to do that, we're now starting some exciting work with partners like Resolve to Save Lives, Tom is on the panel, with national public health agencies with more advanced capabilities to integrate all the new opportunities, whether it's genomics, whether it's population data, whether it's healthcare data, to be better prepared to integrate this rapidly in order to then provide our leaders the opportunity to make the best decisions possible. Listen, we've watched the pandemic, we know that even with the best data, we still can't guarantee that our political leaders will make the best decisions. But that's outside of our gift. They are elected to make decisions. Our responsibility is to give them the best possible opportunity to do so. And I definitely will not want to stand before any political leader in the next pandemic when it comes as it will, in the same situation I was 3 years ago, struggling to collate and, you know, provide them with what they needed to make decisions. So this is an exciting piece of work. It cuts across many aspects: governance, technology, people, resources, intersections, collaboration. But the work has started. And Tom, that's really one of our big challenges and the one piece I wanted to use this incredible opportunity of the beginning of the new bureau to kind of highlight and share with colleagues. Back to you.
Thank you, Chikwe. That was fantastic. I want to move from the multilateral to the regional and talk or move next to Amadou Sall, who leads one of, I think, among the most promising local and regional manufacturing initiatives. And we'd love to hear from you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Tom. And also thanking the organizer and Ambassador Kingesong for inviting us. Coming to a question, there is really two very important lessons that we've learned from COVID and when it comes to coordination. When COVID hit, we were too large in Africa that has the capacity to make the diagnostics. Thanks to coordinations and discussion with Africa CDC, we could train as early as February, 25 countries in Senegal, and a few weeks later, more than 22 countries from South Africa. What is said is when you coordinate, you can have very good access to be able to detect and respond, because that was one of the key questions at the beginning. Second example I want to talk about is the one dealing with medical countermeasure, where really one of the issues was really the AAA access, availability, affordability. Because we end up with Africa CDC as part of this partnership for COVID testing to literally move 3.2 million tests to all these different people from Institut Pasteur in Dakar in coordination from Germany, have to move it. So all these two lessons lead us to very important activity that we have to thought very clearly. Number one, when it comes to medical countermeasure, we have to build a very resilient system by design, meaning that we want to make sure that we have extra capacity that we can leverage if needed. We have to build actually possibilities to have some standardized way to make it. And the third thing, we want to make sure that we can do that in coordination with other people. So what we deliver is something that makes sense. And when I talk about that, during the COVID, we did diagnostics for COVID rapid tests. We could develop in record time these rapid tests that can be channeled throughout West Africa and with West African Health Organization. And we could do the same together with African CDC to reach more people. The other way is the diagnostics, the vaccine. Why the vaccine? Because we are the only WHO pre-qualified vaccine manufacturer in Africa for yellow fever. And we've been this since 1966. We've been making vaccine for more than 80 years. How do we leverage that to deal with security when it comes to vaccines? And that's how, once again, with coordination with Africa CDC, we came up with this partnership for African vaccine manufacturing, which led us today to build a platform where we have end-to-end manufacturing, multi-technology, eggs, cell culture, messenger RNA, going together with R&D, meaning that you developing the vaccine that they're gonna be manufacturing. We also do that in parallel with workforce development. This is a huge gap we have in Africa when it comes to manufacturing. Workforce is very, very important. Regulatory is very important. But dealing with those in coordination with AMA, with Africa CDC, with WHO, is absolutely critical to be able to build those regional hubs that can serve the Africa purpose. Today, we are in a position actually to launch very soon this platform that would, over the next coming years, be able to do 300 million doses of vaccine on pandemic, on routine, and on epidemic vaccine. And this is typically coming out of the COVID. The second part I wanna talk in terms of looking forward is really when it comes to the detection. Very clearly today, it's really important when we talk about surveillance. We understand that having surveillance from the very last mile up to the top central level is something that we have to do. In Senegal, what we have done is really have this digitally empowered syndromic surveillance that go from the community up to the central level. What this gives us is a platform where through that sentinel sites that we spread out within the countries, we could detect within maximum 10 days any epidemics that would happen. Why this is important is when we bring innovation to that, bringing point of care, bringing genomics, you can go down up to 1 to 2 days, you can close that. And this is really critical when we talk about health security, because it's about containing at the source, at the community level, this threat to detect them and respond. Having really this approach, first detector, first responder, at the very last mile, because that last mile is your first mile to build global health security. And that's why on these two sides, the regional manufacturing, on the side of the detection and response, we have to make sure through coordination, we're bringing that together. And that's where I think technology is critically important. Today, being able on each of those sites to find a way to do sequencing within 24 hours, share that samples and this information with other people can be extremely useful, not only to be able for people to get ready, but also bridge that with the capacity on which you manufacture. Today, having a sequence can help you to have a very good molecular testing. Having a sequence using messenger RNA technology can help you start thinking, designing a vaccine. And making sure you can share that at the global level is really where bridging detection and manufacturing capacity with technology like AI, like messenger RNA, like sequencing, you can build something that is very strong to make sure security at the highest level from the regional and from the most local part up to the highest level. Last thing I wanna talk about that, which is really, really important. We tend to really sometimes overlook the role that the health system being extremely strong is very, very important. And that's where also coordination is critical. Because let's be clear, you can have vaccine. Until you have a system that is trying to deliver vaccination, you are really stuck. So it's really, really important that the health system being that channel by which we bring that. And that's where really coordination is important. My last word is, we're doing that in Senegal at Pasteur Institute, but it really matters if we do in coordination that with other hubs. We need to have those different hubs where manufacturing go end-to-end with detection and response and go end-to-end with workforce development. If we have that in different area in a coordinated way, then when we make products, we have a product that is really done, that is really in a context where the market is shaped to be able to absorb that product. That's where the coordination is also critical. We don't all need to do the same sort of vaccine and overwhelm the market with that. But agreeing on the fact that South Africa should focus on some specific vaccines, Senegal, Egypt, Morocco, and other people may help us actually have the right market shaping to be able to make those capacities financially viable and also in the long term being something like a shield that can help not only Africa and the region, but be a very strong foundation for the global health security.
Great, thank you, Amadou. That's a thoughtful and compelling vision. Sticking on the regional theme, I am going to turn next to Peter Piot. Please, Peter.
Yeah, thanks, Tom. And also again, congratulations to John Kengason and his team for organizing this. I'll bring European perspective, but before that, we say we heard a strong rationale starting with Secretary Blinken for including health in foreign policy in general. And it's certainly obvious in time of pandemics. And as John mentioned in the dialogue with Tony Fauci, the UN Security Council discussed AIDS already in 2001, and in 2000, sorry. And it was the first meeting of the millennium, and there was a session on Ebola. But the fact that the biggest epidemic of the last 100 years did not make it to the Security Council, and there was no special session of the UN General Assembly. I'm not talking about a high-level meeting, but a special session, for me, is a failure also of international leadership and the fact that we could not really bring everybody together, which may be explained by the far more complicated environment. But in terms of the Europe, and since we're in the US here, let me remind that the EU, the European Union, is a union of 27 sovereign states, and that health as such has not been a core legal competency of the union. And because there are competencies that are common to the union, such as foreign trade, environmental regulations and industrial norms and so on, but not health. However, COVID has changed that, and because that was one of your questions. And with COVID put health squarely on the political agenda of the union, also thanks to the leadership of President Ursula von der Leyen. And this has resulted in some very concrete actions and activities, the joint procurement of vaccines, uniform vaccine certificate for 27 member states, agreements on continuing free circulation of goods and people, and so on. And now we have what's called a health union, which is one step to ensure health security, not only for the European Union, but beyond that. HERA was created, that's the Health Emergency Response and Preparedness Authority. So there is now a body in the European Commission that is the locus for preparing and dealing with pandemics, stronger mandates for the European Medicines Agency, for the European Center for Disease Control, and also rules for declaring a health emergency within Europe. And I should, of course, specify that healthcare remains a competency of member states, and rightly so, because it's so complex. And we'll hear from the next session from some country representatives what they're doing. And let's not forget that the EU and the Commission plus member states are really basically the largest together, the national development donor, though in the field of global health, the US is still the largest one. But the US and EU really joined hands, and that led to the creation of the pandemic fund. And that's something, that's another illustration of that this has now gone up to the top agenda. But also as a result of COVID, a broader global health strategy for the EU was developed. And not only COVID, but also developments that are there, the emergence of regional bodies. And I think that the role of the EU and the Africa CDC in this pandemic is a turning point in how Africa is no longer waiting for charity from the global north to deal with its own business and emergencies. And also demographic changes and so on. And this strategy was a commission-wide initiative and effort, including for the first time the external service, which is a mini foreign affairs or State Department, although with far less authority. And it explicitly positions global health as an essential pillar of the EU's external policy. And that is really very new. However, it's not yet approved because some member states have problems with the reference to gender and sexual and reproductive health. So for our American friends, you're not the only ones. So what's different in this new strategy? And I mention it because, again, it includes, of course, pandemic preparedness and in a big way. But it's one of first principle is that of partnerships, which is quite a different approach than in the past with our partnerships on equal basis in terms of planning and implementation. Two, it's resolutely multi-sectoral and embraces One Health. Three, it really emphasizes system strengthening from primary healthcare, but also very important when we talk about health security is strengthening national institutes for public health and in each and every country. Something that I, like Chikwe, you've worked on in a big way, but we still have a long way to go. Fourth also is that we need to go beyond infectious diseases and the classic public health, something that Tom has been working on, Tom Frieden in this case, with the diabetes, hypertension, and things like that are becoming and are already the main cause of death and of ill health in many, many countries, also low and middle income countries. And finally, a resolute support for what Amadou is doing is support for regional and local manufacturing. Actually, the EU has allocated 1.1 billion euro to support local manufacturing, not only vaccines, but also diagnostics and drugs in low and low income countries, basically. And finally, the strategy also explicitly calls for stronger collaboration with other regional entities, and the collaboration with EU particularly is really getting stronger and stronger, at least in the field of global health, pandemic preparedness, Africa CDC, but also with other so-called donor countries, and strengthening international organizations. And in other words, it is supporting the global network that was mentioned earlier on. I must say that there was a strategy on global health 2010, but it was never really implemented, partly lack of leadership, partly lack of competencies. But having such a strategy now that puts global health security in a broader context, plus the creation of HERA and other things, plus the numerous activities in member states, means that we are now in a much better position and also to support international efforts. Thanks, I stop here.
Great, thank you, Peter. It's great to hear about the Commission's strategy. We've moved from the multilateral to the regional. We're now going to move to civil society and the role of practitioners in enabling and holding us accountable for this global health coordination. And I'm gonna turn to Peter Hotez next.
Well, thank you so much, Tom, and a shout out to you, Ambassador Nkangasong, and to you, Tom, as well, because I know how hard it is to get important organizations like the United States State Department and the Council on Foreign Relations to care about global health. And so it's a testament not only to your brilliance, but your force of personality. So thank you for that. Just a few comments that I want to make. I'm a vaccine scientist. And if I could, I'd like to use my 3 minutes, and I hear Wolf Blitzer's producer shouting in my ear, wrap up. My 3 minutes to address the two issues that I see around vaccine equity, because I am a vaccine scientist, that are somewhat non-intuitive. And first around promoting vaccine equity, access, and also countering anti-vaccine activism. Regarding the access feature, we developed two recombinant protein COVID vaccines that wound up reaching 100 million people. Corbivax in India, produced by Biological E, and Biopharma in Indonesia, produced Indovac, which became one of the first halal COVID vaccines. And so we provide a proof of concept that you don't have to be a big pharma company to do big things. But the backstory was, you know, in 2020 and 2021, we were getting frantic phone calls from ministers of health and ministers of science across the African continent, in Asia, in Latin America. The reason why? Because they realized that the mRNA vaccines weren't coming, right? Weren't coming anytime soon. They realized the particle vaccines weren't coming anytime soon. Could we help them? We did. We transferred the technology, no patent, no strings attached, and 100 million people got immunized. The problem was, in my view, it was a science policy failure. We were so focused on speed and so focused on innovation, and what I sometimes say in my moments of frustration, the shiny new toys, that nobody had the situational awareness to step back and say, hey, if we only focus on new technologies like mRNA and particle vaccines, there's a learning curve before you go from zero to the 15 billion doses that we needed. And so what happened was, in those early days, enough vaccine got produced to get bought up by North American countries and Europe and Japan, leaving the low and middle income countries out in the cold. We can't let that happen again. And I think very much of my colleague here, that means empowering the vaccine producers in the low and middle income countries, but really empowering them, not dictating what vaccines that they're going to make, or not relying on the big pharma companies to develop the technology and hope the crumbs filter down to the low and middle income countries. We're not there yet. The second piece of that vaccine access piece is empowering the national regulatory authorities in those countries. The WHO pre-qualification mechanism failed during the pandemic. What happened was, the big companies came in, they put a velvet rope around the big pharma companies, and most of the low and middle income country vaccine producers couldn't get their vaccines pre-qualified by WHO. The alternative strategy is to have stringent regulatory authorities. They can do this and have it largely rubber stamped by the WHO pre-qualifying mechanism. But who are the stringent regulatory authorities? US FDA in the US, you know where this is going, Canada, the UK, the EMA, in Europe, Australia, and Japan, all high-income countries. We're not empowering national regulatory authorities in India and in Indonesia and Brazil to take this on. We have to fix that. That's the second piece. Regarding the other piece, countering vaccine hesitancy, it's a disaster. My new book, The Deadly Rise of Anti-Science, says that 200,000 Americans, 200,000 needlessly died because they refused a COVID vaccine. They were not victims of misinformation. They were not victims of infodemic, meaning they were not victims of some random junk appearing on the internet. It was an organized, targeted, predatory, politically motivated anti-vaccine ecosystem that came out of the highest levels of the United States Congress and the House Freedom Caucus, Senators Rand Paul, Senators Ron Johnson, amplified every night on Fox News, and it killed 200,000 Americans, including 40,000 people in my state of Texas. And now it's globalizing. And I met with Dr. Tedros last year at this time. It's going not only into Canada and Europe, but it's going into low and middle income countries. And you're seeing it affect the uptake of the malaria vaccine, for instance. This thing is a monster. And so now everyone's talking about empowering organizations like Institute Pasteur and Dakar to make mRNA vaccines. Right now, the mRNA technology could be dead in the water. And why do I say that? Because if you look at what's happened in the US right now with the bivalent vaccines, fewer than 20% of Americans took the bivalent vaccines last year. The new XBB booster annual immunization, I took it and about six other Americans took it. That's going to be our new starting place when the next pandemic hits and mRNA vaccines, because the anti-vaccine lobby has become so powerful. I got into this because I have four adult kids, including Rachel, has autism and intellectual disabilities, and wrote a book a few years ago called Vaccines Did Not Cause Rachel's Autism, which made me public enemy number one or two with the anti-vaccine groups. Our good friend Robert F. Kennedy Jr. has publicly labeled me the OG villain, which I'm so old and square, I had to look up what that means, the original gangster villain. So thank you for having the original gangster villain talk to you.
It's a pleasure. Thank you so much for that. With that, we will turn last, but certainly not least, to my CFR colleague, Tom Frieden, whose organization is doing a remarkable breadth of activities on this. And I would love to hear from you, Tom.
Thank you so much. And I really appreciate being on the panel with so many great folks. And I don't want to repeat what's been said. You asked, what are the biggest successes and failures? And I think with individuals and organizations, greatest strength and greatest weakness are often two sides of the same coin. And I would say that's the case with our response to COVID. Vaccines, measures to reduce infections, and treatments. All of them had huge successes and huge failures. Vaccines, who could have thought that within a year we'd have a remarkably effective vaccine? And yet, the unacceptable failure of solidarity resulting in deaths around the world when there was demand for vaccine, and the partisan infection of vaccines that's potentially undermining not just COVID, but many other public health programs. Second, measures to reduce infections. Closures, masks, ventilation, they worked. They dramatically tamped down the acute phase, and they ignited a partisanship and undermined trust in public health and government. So again, strength and failure. And treatment. We had good treatments early on, steroids for severely ill people, Paxlovid and others, excellent new guidelines just released by WHO, very clear, and yet huge failure to apply what works. So you've asked, what are we doing differently because of this? And I think, to me, we've worked with WHO to promote a target which allows acceleration, accountability, and advocacy, 717. Every single outbreak found within 7 days of emergence, reported to public health within 1 day, and all essential control measures in place within 7 days. It gives you a way of using every single outbreak, cholera, measles, yellow fever, food poisoning, whatever, as a way of strengthening your system. But to me, one of the biggest changes is the growing recognition, difficult as it is, that we have to engage with strengthening of primary health care. Primary health care is essential. We've outlined what epidemic-ready primary health care would look like. Whether it's treatment of hypertension, thank you, Peter, for the shout out on that. It's the world's leading cause of death, accounts for less than 1% of global health funding. This is not acceptable either ethically or epidemiologically. Whether it's vaccination, detection of outbreaks, response to outbreaks, HIV, TB, malaria, the 717 target, all of the public health programs stumble on the weakness of primary healthcare systems. And we have to address this. We have to address the financing, the governance, the linkage with hospitals, the relation with hospitals. We've got 50 years of very little progress strengthening primary healthcare. And if we keep not looking at how to make that happen, we're going to be in a very difficult situation going forward. We do see programs like PEPFAR substantially strengthening the platform, not just of HIV treatment, but primary care services. But to me, this is one of the main lessons that we have to do more to make primary healthcare truly, not just in rhetoric, but in reality, the center of our healthcare systems.
Great. Well, I have good news and I have bad news. The good news is our six panelists have done the remarkable feat of delivering important, inspiring remarks within 40 minutes, and I'm grateful for them for that. The bad news is I'm not sure we have time for questions. We have time for one? We can take one. Okay, terrific. Please, sir. If we could have your question, if you recall, this event is on the record, and if you'd state your name and affiliation, please.
Sure, I'm Daniel Singer. I'm on assignment from the CDC. I just want to pull on a thread that Dr. Hotez mentioned, which is this morning Dr. Fauci talked about all of the technological about the advancements that came through COVID-19, but the implementation of them was impeded by a lack of trust of science and a lack of trust of scientists and inadequate trust of governments and between governments. So my question for the panel is, how are we going to advance those disciplines of diplomacy and risk communication so that we actually can implement the technologies that we are developing so that for the next event, we're not fighting ourselves at the same time we're fighting a virus?
Great. Thank you for that excellent question. Again, we are short on time, so I'm just gonna call on two speakers who have not spoken on that particular topic to give them the chance to. And why don't we go to people, let's start with people in the room. And I'm interested to hear from Amadou, if you could start us off, particularly when you're thinking about building up regional capacity in Africa, how do you think about this issue of trust and confidence in the products that you're working hard to be able to produce?
I think one of the most important things that broke that trust is things happened very late. And for me, the fact that you have regional capacity is something that would help give these people, they have some self-reliance, would help a lot. And the other things which is important is bringing the right information. We've done very good studies on why people are not getting vaccinated, even healthcare workers. And if they get the right information, this is the best way actually to bring them in. We should not stop informing people with what is the right thing. We know it's tough, but this is the way to go, bringing more and more the right information and getting people being the actors of their own work. And clearly, if you build the capacities, dedicate them to do HIV, to do things that are on a regular basis a problem for them, that's also how you make the system more being trust and help actually build those trust in more general terms.
Great. Winnie, HIV has a history on this. This is not a new problem for HIV in terms of misinformation on effective countermeasures. Would you give us a minute of your thoughts on this topic of building trust?
I think the elephant in the room is how science is rewarded and how health technologies are traded. This is a barrier, huge barrier in the global economy. Long ago, science was not rewarded the way it is today. Science was not traded the way it is today. Health science was not. But today, you can trade a life-saving technology the way you trade this luxury handbag. It can't be right. A technology that saves lives has to be invested in by public resources, as it was here. Moderna was paid for largely by American taxpayers, and must also be traded with regulations by the public. There must be public regulation on life-saving technologies. We see now that that was over time taken away. So now you can have a company using public resources to produce something that saves lives and then privatize the benefits of that product, of the profits from it. It's not right. We need a global system where we protect, yes, innovation, but at the same time, save lives as well. That's what we were fighting for with the TRIPS waiver at the WTO, that when there's a pandemic, that something kicks in that says, first we will save lives, you will get profits, but there'll be reasonable profits, not super profits. People will be saved, and then you can continue making even more profits after that. So regulation of how health products are, health technologies are traded is critical. And we still need to do some work through the pandemics treaty. It seems to me that we will not be prepared for the next pandemic unless we address this issue of access to health technologies head on through that treaty as well.
Great. We have just a couple of minutes before the next session. I do feel badly about shortchanging our other speakers. So I'm going to ask each of you just 30 seconds or a minute at most. Chikwe, why don't we go to you next on surveillance, WHO. How are you building trust in that information?
Thanks, Tom. Very quickly. I think whatever we can build surveillance for the next pandemic, right? We have to build surveillance for the things happening every day in our countries and enable local communities, local public health leaders to respond to that, which is their priority to respond to. And the more we do that, the more we build trust that the health system is able to detect and respond to the priorities of every community. And then on top of that, we can hope that this system will work in a pandemic, or we'll say it's much more likely to work in a pandemic if it works for the small outbreaks, small incidences that matter to every community working around the world. And that's our target in the next few years.
Great. Thank you, Chikwe. Peter, 30 seconds or a minute from you.
Yeah. First of all, this is not only about lack of trust or mistrust or misinformation about vaccines. It's a trust in technology, in governments, in policies, in science. And as Peter said, you know, Peter Hotez, we should not be naive. This is not only just a spontaneous type of thing. So we need to understand, because it's complex. It's not the same reasons that are behind it, because it's often about something else that are the same in every population. So we need actually develop also a science of it, understanding, and then invest the means in going and reestablishing trust. You know, in public health, we've just neglected the whole thing of just working with people, with communities, and we need to invest as much in, let's say, in marketing, to use that term, in understanding and working with people, as we, you know, as big companies are doing. So that requires specific budgets. Otherwise, we will always be faced with the same problem, particularly in polarizing political contexts. Over.
Great. Thank you, Peter. Tom, you have experience with this, TB in New York City, Ebola at the CDC. Any brief thoughts from you?
Communication is key, and communication is two-way. It means listening and finding the messages that resonate and the messengers who can be heard. It means being frank about what we know, when we know it. As we learn more, being frank about that, what we don't know, that's essential. And I also go back to the primary healthcare point. There are many, many people who are not going to get vaccinated for this or the next threat unless their doctor who they trust recommends it. But far too many people don't have a doctor or clinician who they trust. So get the message right, get the messenger right, strengthen primary health care, and hone those communication skills. So we're frank with people. We tell people what we know when we know it. We're first right and empathetic, credible. It's not going to be easy. It's a much broader trend than public health, but we can be part of the solution.
Great. It's unfair to ask Peter Hotez to ask him sum up a career focus in 30 seconds, but if you'd like to give us your thoughts.
Yeah, no, I mean, I'm in agreement with everything that was said. But, you know, I my big view right now is that the health sector really doesn't know what to do. And so what you see is the health sector kind of skirting around the edges, right? We have to talk to the heads of the social media companies so things don't go viral. Yes, of course. We have to improve our system of health communication. Yes, of course. We have to reach out to trusted community leaders. Yes, of course. You do all those things. You do all those things well. We'll get to about 30 to 40% of the problem, but we won't get the big piece. The big piece is that this is an organized movement that is threatening global health, and we have to take it on with the same urgency that we do other global health pandemic threats. And yet we're not prepared to do that. It means reaching across sectors and talking to other UN agencies. It means for the Biden administration or whoever's in power after 2024 to not only talk to the Health and Human Services agencies, but it means talking to people who know about this kind of stuff in Homeland Security, the State Department, because of Putin's involvement and using this as a wedge issue, and other foreign actors, the Commerce Department, the Justice Department. They may have a better understanding of the levers that we have to pull and push. We're not doing that so far.
Great. Well, thank you to the indulgence of my CFR colleagues. Let me get everyone's view on this. It probably has come at the cost of your coffee break, but I hope you feel like it was worth it. Please join me in thanking our speakers.